Welcome back to Money Life, where we're doing two big interviews today. Our first of them is now with Greg Fisher, the Chief Investment Officer from Gerstein Fisher. Interesting firm that does some really good commentary. And if you want to check out that commentary, which I read, you should go to gersteinfisher.com. If you want to get linked and like notices when they're doing that commentary, then follow them on Twitter. They're at Gerstein Fisher. But one of the commentaries that Greg and the crew did recently was talking about the trouble with momentum. And investors have benefited a lot from momentum. But now with the market kind of showing, hey, we want to take a lot of that general direction off the table, investors are struggling. So again, if you want to learn more about what they think about it than what you hear on the show, go to gersteinfisher.com. But right now, I'm very pleased to say, Greg Fisher, welcome back to Money Life.
Thank you, Chuck. It's great to be here, and thank you.
So we are looking at a market that ever since the lows after the financial crisis in 2008 gave us a lot of sort of extra returns based on momentum. It was kind of everything rising with the tide. We are seeing momentum shaken out of the market by basically all the volatility we've had lately. So when you look at it, how is that shaking confidence for investors? And indeed, what should people be doing about it?
Well, certainly, I think there's a couple of issues here. One is the issue of momentum and defining it, understanding how it works. And then the second is just the recent volatility in the markets and how investors might think about that. We've been talking about momentum in security prices and momentum in asset classes for a while now. The thing about momentum, this concept of momentum investing, is basically where you're comparing some set of securities across their peers. So whether markets are volatile or not, whether markets are going up or down in any country, in any sector, we can always compare all of these things to one another, and you're always going to be able to rank them by which of them are growing faster than the others and which of them are losing more than the others. So if everything's trending up, there's going to be something moving faster than all others trending up. And if everything is trending down, there's going to be something trending down faster than everything else. This concept of momentum investing should always be something we could look at, but the recent volatility is certainly causing investors a lot of concern. In the article we recently wrote that you and I talked a little bit about, we were really commenting on one of the challenges with momentum investing in general, particularly in this market where there's so much volatility, is that when there's a lot of cross-sectional dispersion in securities, when things are moving around very differently from one another, if you're ranking a portfolio on momentum, what you're end up going to do is you're going to end up buying securities that have grown faster than their peers in some prior period, maybe 6 months or a year, and having those securities in your portfolio. But these things move around so quickly that if you were looking at ranking those securities every month, every day, every quarter, you're going to end up having to trade those securities frequently. And one of the challenges with momentum in all markets, but particularly this one, is it creates a lot of turnover, which could cause investors to have tax liabilities and or trading costs. So what would be some smart ways to sort of weave momentum into your investment strategy without necessarily having to have the benefits of owning momentum in your portfolio be eliminated because of all of this turnover? Mm-hmm. And that's really what our article was about. Now, what we talk about there is ways to combine momentum with other investments. So you might think about diversification. Normally, we think about diversification when we invest, whether it be different types of securities or sectors or countries or regions or styles. Momentum is a type of factor. And when you think about diversification across factor returns, examples would be value investing, momentum investing, small company stocks, large company stocks. These are what we all consider factors. And when you diversify across factors, you can think about not only owning momentum in your strategy, but using momentum as one of many things. What we found is that when you diversify properly and you use a multiple factor strategy where momentum is just one of many things, you could embrace a large part of this momentum premium, but you can dial down the turnover by incorporating other things such as value stocks. If you think about momentum as a way to slow down your trading when you have a value strategy, or think about value as a way to slow down your trading when you have a momentum strategy, because these two things move very differently. by definition, if you think about it, a momentum stock is one whose price has grown a lot relative to its peers. And then you ultimately have a stock that might have a high price relative to some fundamental, like book value or earnings, whatever you might be looking at. Whereas a value stock is almost the reverse. A value stock is often a company whose price has declined relative to some other fundamental. And now you might have a stock with a low price relative to book value or earnings or something else. So by definition, momentum stocks and value stocks are kind of different than one another. One has a high price and the other has a low price relative to something fundamental in general. So by combining these things in one strategy, you end up with diversification, but it also helps this trading cost problem that momentum has had for many years. And to some degree, this is something we've actually been doing live in our strategies in the Gersting Fisher funds for the last decade or so. We've been using this type of approach, a multiple factor approach, incorporating both momentum and value amongst other things in our strategies. And it works quite well, particularly around this trading cost issue.
Do you, for most investors look at it as I want the sides of growth and value. Do you look at it as I want momentum and value? Do you use momentum to signify the kind of growth stocks you want? Help my audience understand if there is a difference for you between growth stocks and momentum stocks.
Yeah, it's a good question. So a couple thoughts on that. There is a difference. You might think about it in this way. As a matter of fact, lots of research has been done, both by our firm, Gersting Fisher, and also by many academics, where we show that momentum investing actually works better amongst growth stocks than it does amongst value stocks. So you can be a growth investor without having a momentum tilt. So for example, if I were to go out and just buy a basket of growth stocks, maybe the growth index, I'm basically neutral to momentum because I'm screening my securities for growth stocks. So I'm only looking at growth stocks as compared to value stocks or something else. So in the universe of growth stocks defined by somebody, there's lots of ways to define these things, but let's just assume you're looking at only growth companies. If you just bought the market, you'd be neutral to momentum amongst growth stocks. But from there, you could then sort the securities within the growth universe and have a larger weighting to securities that have grown faster than all the others in that universe. So if I had 100 stocks in that universe and I ranked them all from high to low, those that are growing faster than the others and those that are losing more than the others, I'm going to have those with high momentum and those with low momentum. If I tilt my portfolio amongst growth stocks to those high momentum securities and underweight the negative momentum securities, I now have a growth portfolio with more momentum than where I started, let's call it the market basket. So there is a difference between momentum investing and growth investing, but it is worth noting that momentum investing works better amongst growth stocks than it does if you were to do something similar amongst value stocks. There's lots of research to suggest why that might be happening. I could describe that if it's interesting, but that is in fact the case. Similarly, when we look at value stocks, you could buy a value portfolio, maybe the value index, and that's not a bad thing to consider when you're investing. But if you wanted to have a portfolio that had more exposure to the value factor, what you could do is you could rank your securities amongst value securities only. Once again, I'm looking only at value stocks now. I can rank them all for, let's say, their price-to-book ratio from high to low. Those with the highest price relative to their book ratio, you might think of those as the growthiest of value stocks, but they're still value stocks. And then those with the lowest price-to-book value, and think of those as the most value-oriented value stocks. So you could have a portfolio of value stocks that's more value-oriented or more sensitive to the value factor than maybe the value index or a portfolio that were neutral to that. Now, the final point I would make is in scenario one, I talked about buying, let's say, the growthiest of growth stocks or those with high momentum.
Yep.
And in scenario two, I talked about buying the most value-oriented value stocks. When we put together a very growthy, momentum-tilted growth portfolio, and combine that with a deeply discounted value portfolio, those two things together in a portfolio, 50% each rebalanced from time to time, actually has better risk and return attributes than if we were to buy just the sort of neutralized indices. This is at its core what we talk about when we talk about multi-factor investing. The industry is calling this different things: smart beta, factor investing, scientific beta. There's lots of things that are going on in the industry to describe what we're now talking about. But ultimately, it's this idea of getting deeper into these factor premiums that you're looking to have in your portfolio, and very importantly, thinking about how to combine them in a sensible way so that you view your portfolio as a portfolio as compared to competition across the constituent parts.
Very interesting stuff. Greg, let's turn the topic a little bit, because as you're describing this, of course, we're talking about this strategy in a current market that is distinctly changing. So how much do you view this as an all-market strategy, and how do you see the market changing and forcing investors to change?
Well, I mean, the markets haven't changed in that, you know, there's still a buyer for every seller. You know, the capital markets seem to be working. There's more volatility today than we've seen. I mean, let's face it, what have we seen? Was a 12,000-point increase in the Dow from the bottom of the market, you know, over 5 or so years ago. So, you know, the markets are still doing their thing. They're volatile. I've actually just finished putting something together that's going to be up on our website probably later today, where we've gone back and we've looked at volatility in the markets back to the 1920s. You know, how often do markets move 10% in 10 days like we just saw recently, or, you know, roughly? But, you know, volatility occurs. I think that these strategies we're describing, though, are ones that are evergreen. These are principles that have worked, you know, through the test of time. And these kinds of things, when they work, it's, what I mean by that is it doesn't mean that, you know, value investing is going to work forever, or that momentum investing is going to work every year, every quarter, forever. But what it does mean is there's some good economic rationale for why these things happen. There is a positive expected return on these themes and ideas. And for long-term investors that weave these things into their portfolios in a sensible way and, you know, remain strategically invested over long periods, there is good reason to believe that there'd be a reward for investing in these ideas over the long term. In the short run, though, investors have to make sure that they're doing some basic things. Number one is, you know, you've got to make sure you've got adequate liquidity, you don't have a lot of debt. You know, there's some basic things that cause investors to derail their long-term plans. When you tilt the portfolio to value stocks or momentum investments or some other things we could talk about, you're deliberately going to differentiate from the market. There are some investors that can't be comfortable when the returns of their portfolio are different than their friends. So, in other words, if the market is up 10% and you're up 8%, because you had more exposure to value stocks, you know, the fact is, over the long term, value investing may have done better than growth investing, but that has not been the case over many periods, including the last 10 years. So imagine you did this thing where you tilted your portfolio to value stocks, and all of your friends have made more money than you in the S&P 500 because that did better than value investing. If you're someone who knows that you're not going to be comfortable with that, then you need to be in more of a market portfolio. These factors are risk factors. They're risk. And to earn the premium, you have to be able to be willing to be different than others. So in markets like this one, where people's returns are very different and there's more volatility, you know, having a strategy you feel comfortable with, I think, is critical.
Greg, we've come to the end of our time. Thanks so much for taking time out with me. I hope we get a chance to chat again soon.
Thank you so much for the opportunity. Look forward to speaking with you soon.
Greg Fisher is the Chief Investment Officer at Gerstein Fisher. If you want more information, if you want to see the paper we've talked about on momentum and much more, go to GersteinFisher.com. They're on Twitter at Gerstein Fisher. We've just hit the halfway pole on today's edition of Money Life, but there's much more to go, so settle back and relax. We'll be right back with more in just a moment.